Before we begin, let me just announce that in celebration of Diversity Week, we will have a spoken word event entitled Melanin Monologue, November 1st at 7 p.m. It's sponsored by Kaluma Players, Black Student Alliance, and Libations. And this evening's event is sponsored by, well, co-sponsored by Minority Clubs United, Black Student Alliance, and Traylon Neal. I'm also asked to ask all of you, please, in advance of our speaker coming, to turn off your phones. I love the response I get to that. People start fidgeting and grabbing things. Because it can be safely presumed that everyone has one. Let me introduce our speaker for this evening, Attorney Pamela J. Means. She concluded her one-year term as president of the National Bar Association on July 23, 2015, a term that began just 9 days before Michael Brown was shot in Ferguson, Missouri. During her term as president of the NBA, the National Bar Association, the nation's oldest and largest organization of legal professionals, Ms. Means was responsible for guiding the organization through the turmoil in the months following the shooting, as well as representing the NBA in dealings with government officials on local, state, and federal levels. Prior to serving the National Bar Association as president, she served as president-elect and as NBA vice president. Ms. Means is also a past director of the NBA's Region 8 and is a past president of the Mound City Bar Association. She is currently a partner with Thompson Coburn, St. Louis's largest law firm, and as a partner in the firm's litigation and public law practices, Ms. Means represents a variety of clients on a wide range of matters from land use, eminent domain, and contract disputes to employment and personnel issues, and many, many others besides. Since joining the firm, Ms. Means has represented such clients as McLeod USA, Energizer Battery Company, Shell Oil, Metro, Monsanto, the Metropolitan Sewer District, East St. Louis Children's Mission Incorporated, St. Louis Women's Healthcare, and many others in addition to those. In addition, she played a significant role in the land acquisition for the 17-mile extension of Metrolink through St. Clair County on behalf of the Bi-State Development Agency. She is also active with local and state legal organizations and with a number of area civic organizations. She holds a BA from Monmouth College, an MA from Clark Atlanta University, and a JD from the University of Iowa. But even more importantly than all of this, she is a demonstration of what happens when you are one of my students. Pamela J. Means.
Dr. Scott for that amazing introduction, and he is right. This is a product of his teaching. So if I say something provocative, blame it on Dr. Scott. If I say something that upsets you, blame it on Dr. Scott. If I say something that makes you uncomfortable, blame it on Dr. Scott, a product of Dr. Scott. Thank you so much to the student unions and the student groups that invited me here on today. Thank you to the president of this university, but most importantly, thank you to Reverend Andrea Cornett Scott, who's the director of inclusion here, for always being my first mentor, my friend, and for inviting me to be a part of this. Ms. Scott said she doesn't really invite you, she kind of tells you what you're going to do, and you obey. And so I did. So students don't feel uncomfortable. She has a 30-year history of doing that. So today I came to talk to you about the Ferguson effect. The more things change, the more they stay the same. What is the Ferguson effect? Depending on who you ask the question to, you may get two drastically different responses. For some, the unrest in Ferguson more than a year ago and elsewhere across America resulted in criminals feeling emboldened to resist police authority and or caused police officers to exercise restraint and the fear of criticism. This view, just this morning, 7 hours ago, was expressed by FBI Director James Comey. Others have said that the Ferguson effect describes a political movement where oppressed African Americans stood up for rights that were being denied. When we look at the first argument, argument, it really centers around a theory that Ferguson erupted a new violent crime wave that emerged and is directly traceable to those who protested police brutality. Writing recently in the Wall Street Journal, Heather McDonald of the Manhattan Institute rose the specter of rising crime and homicide across the nation as a result of Ferguson. Advocates for this argument allege that there is an empowered criminal element and by extension a horrific increase in murders, shooting, and other violent crimes. The supporters argue that statistics, if you look at them, have never been worse. And they use statistics like this and listen. Baltimore alleges that police officers maintain that gun violence is up by 60% compared to last year, with 32% shooting happening over Memorial Day weekend. In Milwaukee, homicides were up by 180% through April. Shootings in St. Louis were up by 39%, robberies by 43%, homicides by 25%. And according to St. Louis Alderman Joe Vecchio, he has never seen crime be so high. But now if we think about this, we've heard this before with this chilling effect. In the 1960s, Lyndon Johnson launched what was called the War on Crime. And in the 1970s, Nixon gave us the War on Drugs. In the early 1900s, those effects ran red hot as the media sensationalized youth crime, instilling widespread hysteria, most notably around the beating and the rape of the jogger in the New York City Central Park. And subsequent to that was the conviction and the imprisonment of 5 Black and Latino youth, who, by the way, were released and finally exonerated in 2002 due to DNA evidence. Amid the uproar surrounding the Central Park jogger, conservative academicians quickly gave scholarly blessings to the media's assertion with the following at the Manhattan Institute promulgating something called the super predator theories. We faced and bombastically embraced this concept of the crime boom of the Black youth with no respect for human life, who would spread from inner city neighborhoods to upscale central city districts, inner rings into the suburb, and even into the raw heartland to rob, kill, steal all that was out there. Frightened by this theory, they predicted that these predators, no, the young Black men, by 2010, there would be over 270,000 additional juvenile super predators roaming the streets. By the end of the 1990s, nearly every state had increased youth incarceration and lowered the age at which minors could be tried and sentenced as adults. And severe, lengthy sentences in county jails, of which over 1,100 jails were built between 1970 and 2000. The hysterical predictions never materialized, though. We didn't see it. Despite criminalizing even more the activity of Blacks and poor men and youth and adult crime, guess what happened? The crime rate fell in the 1990s and in the new century. Crime rates would only a few exceptions have continued their several decades of long decline. And in places where there have been increases, we still see them at all-time low. Pivoting crime rate increases around Ferguson and the Black Lives protests around the protesters is simply not supported by any data. In fact, the crime rate that they often point to are crimes that happened before the Ferguson uprise. New York, known as the national showcase of the broken windows theory, the stop and frisk, the racial profile, the harsh sentencing provides an even stronger example. See, the concept is get them at minor crimes, it'll prevent them from doing major crimes. No data, but people believed it. You know, people embrace these concepts and have owned these concepts despite a decline in the proactive policy that we've seen across America. People actually say, why would individuals in Ferguson and this movement called the Black Lives Matter movement, why would you be focusing on police brutality when you actually should be focusing on black-on-black crime? That's where you should be fixing the problem. Here is the problem with that theory. Two. One, I have never seen an African-American male kill another African-American male and escape punishment. Number two, an African-American male that attends school or lives next to or that just comports with another African is not paid to protect the civil or political liberties of that individual. Officers are. That's comparing an apple to a peanut. They don't compare. Number two, if you looked at the most recent FBI statistics, it actually says that black-on-black crime is declining and white-on-white crime is increasing. So if, in fact, you utilize stricter police tactics and there is this major criminal element that is rising, it seems that the overprotection of people will be done in white communities instead of black communities, which is why the argument makes no sense. The other side of the coin. Individuals have argued that, no, that's not what Ferguson actually delivered. What it delivered was a political movement where oppressed African Americans stood up for their rights. More people challenging the police, more people filing lawsuits, more people confronting police brutality and demanding reform. But the more things change, the more they stay the same. Police brutality is not a new concept in the African American community. Contrary to popular belief, the Black Panthers did not form because they wanted to carry some guns. If you read their 10th point preamble, number 3 in it is put an immediate end to police brutality and the killing of our people. The more things change, the more they stay the same. So the concept of police brutality has been around since the, let's say, the Marines in Mississippi. It was the police that actually burned them. Rappers rapped about it in the 80s. But it was easier for us to shoot the messenger than to hear the message. And most of us, if we are being honest with ourselves in the Black community, when Black men said that cops were just stopping them because they were driving while Black, we didn't believe it. We said it had to have been doing something. They didn't treat you like that. Because the reality of it is we are more inclined to believe that which is bad about individuals that look like us or people of color. I get to go home tomorrow, so if you don't like what I'm saying, blame it on Dr. Scott. So the question becomes, for those who make the argument that this, the Ferguson effect, is the eruption of a political movement, I kind of say the jury is still out. You can't really know the effect of this movement until somebody writes about it about 10 years later. But I will tell you that whether Michael Brown's murder created a political movement in time remains to be seen, but there is no question that events such as the Michael Brown murder can provide a moral shock that political movements need to build
and build their ranks from, and bring attention to some of America's hypocrisy and some of the deep-seated problems in America. For instance, the Michael Brown situation, Sandra Bland, it could be like the 14-year-old Emmett Till in 1955, or the beating death of Matthew Shepard in 1988. Transformative episodes that remake the perception and force of society to abandon deep-seated racial practices. Or they can be like the 1991 beating of Rodney King by Los Angeles police officers, a horrific event that failed to create any sustaining push for broader nationwide reform of police practices. A careful examination of our history reveals that the outrage against the police is something that typically happens in a 10-year interval. If you look at it from 1979, the beating death of Arthur McDuffie by the police, which sparked protest and violence in Miami, to the attack on King, which led to more than 50 deaths and several days after the unrest in Los Angeles. And then in 2001, the shooting death of the 19-year-old Timothy Thomas in Cincinnati, which also erupted a protest and rioting and produced a costly economic boycott against the city. And some of you all are saying, who are those people? Because what we often do in situations like this is take moments and get excited about them, but rarely do we take those moments and convert them into movement. Very few. Till had the ability to do that. It was Till that sparked the civil rights movement. Very disciplined. And you all honor and praise and love and just revere Dr. Martin Luther King. But don't you know they couldn't stand him at that time? Because he was taking a concept. He was just a spokesperson. He really wasn't a leader, but he was just a spokesperson. But he was taking the tentaments of what they put together to move forward. He was taking it and expressing that, but he was really fighting against a system of leaders in the NAACP and the Urban League who was used to lobbying to get results. Young folks got tired of that, and they said no more, because you're not yielding any results. So what they took was direct action, and they coupled it with civil disobedience. And it produced the Civil Rights Act of 1965. And it produced the Voting Rights Act of 1966. It did that. It had an objective. So young people, when folk tell you to sit down, to shut up, to be quiet, I say ignore them. That the Panthers were attempting to do, that black rappers desperately wanted to do. You have started the process of converting these moments into a movement. Now, why do I say that? Three things, and I'm going to stop and let you ask questions. One, if you look at the Rodney Brown, Michael Brown situation, something that was different about this than the Rodney King situation is those protesters, and I like to call them leaders, those leaders started putting the blame where it belonged. There was a widespread belief among black and white Americans that the hairstyle, the clothing, the music, the speech of poor and working class black youth were the causes of the aggressive police reactions. Basically, that kids were asking for it. Pull your pants up and the police won't pull you up. This belief reflects a long-standing tradition of respectable politics in which progression against poverty and discrimination must flow from black people behaving differently better. In a nationwide poll, 2008 by ABC News and Columbia University Center on African American Politics and Society, 44% of African Americans said they believe that the reason African Americans face difficulty moving forward was because they lacked individual initiative. 33% said that they lacked, the lack of black progress was caused by racism in society. In the wake of Ferguson, many blacks and whites were awoken to the idea that the lack of respectability is not the problem. The problem is police practices in black and brown communities. In the case of Brown, the allegation of his role in strong-arming and robbing someone before he encountered with the officer Darren Wilson did not defuse the protest. Indeed, the accusations heightened the residents, angered them, and because many failed to see the connection between the alleged robbery and the Brown shooting, got them outraged. At the National Bar Association, so man, we filed a lawsuit against Ferguson to release everything there was about the officer. How is it that you can produce everything you have on the victim and you try him in the public, but you release nothing on the shooter? We said no, the courts afford us an opportunity. And so you saw in the Garner case, in Sean Bell, in the Sandra Bland case, blame being placed where it belongs, on the officers and their aggressive policing, the blue line that caused good cops to remain silent and expose those who wouldn't say a word. Number two, and here's where I think the greatest effect is, they took it online. While the streets of Ferguson was the scene of protest and confrontation, it was social media, and in particular what they coined as Black Twitter, that emerged as a powerful form for activism and debate regarding Ferguson. Few can dispute that social media helped sway public opinion by challenging racially based interpretations of the Brown killing. For example, Black people on Twitter and Facebook started to post images of themselves in formal dressed in a business suit alongside a picture of themselves in informal attire, and they began asking whether they deserve to be under speculation because of the way they were dressed in this picture as opposed to this picture.
All right.
They posted individual and group photos with their hands raised in a gesture of surrender, with the hashtags such as hands up, don't shoot, and Black Lives Matter, and they use social media to coordinate movements and protests. And I will tell you that traditional Black leaders couldn't keep up. And they were angry, and they were mad, and they were disturbed. How dare you not respect leadership? I said, keep on disrespecting. No question that social media did and continues to become the game changer of Black activism. Let me tell you, when it comes to police brutality, everybody says, has it gotten worse? Or are we just seeing more? The civil discrimination in America in the 60s didn't start in the 60s. It was persistent and it was ongoing. But it was when the leaders of the movement decided to utilize the media to expose America's hypocrisy that America finally woke up. She hates looking bad. And so the issue of discrimination and racism was no longer an issue of blacks, but it was America's issue. And you saw white clergy, and you saw white women, and brown women, and individuals standing hand to hand, and they say, these are our sisters and brothers, and they bleed as we bleed, they eat as we eat, they drink as we eat, and we will not allow you to continue to treat them like second-class citizens. What changed? People saw it on television. Poor Congress sticking the dogs on folks. And what young people did with social media is they said the law allows you to videotape an officer with what he's doing. When you get the video, post it immediately and keep posting and keep posting and keep posting and keep posting. And I will tell you, that's how they caught my attention. There was a young man in New Jersey named Marcus Cheater. He was 26 years old. Him and his girlfriend got into an altercation. The cops were called. The police told him to leave. He left, and about a couple of minutes later, they pulled him over on the side of the road. And you could hear, and there was a video camera, and you could hear the police saying, "Stop pulling at my gun. Stop pulling at my gun. Stop resisting arrest. Be still. Da 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 da." Then you see him like yank him out the car. "Stop resisting arrest. Stop pulling my gun. Da 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 da." He gets arrested. Prosecutor says, "I'm going to prosecute him to the full extent of the law. I'm going to make an example of him that you do not put the police officer's life at risk." Don't believe me, look this up. Marcus Cheater, write it down. Marcus Cheater goes and hires an African-American lawyer. And he says to the African-American lawyer, "It didn't happen that way." He said, "What do you mean it didn't happen that way?" He said, "It didn't happen that way. When they were grabbing at me, when they were shoving me, my hands were in the air." The lawyer said, "I thought, he got me lying. That's not right." A year into the situation, right before they were getting ready to go to trial, his lawyer sends out what we call a sunshine request. And he asks for all of the evidence. And what he found that was in addition to a tape camcorder that was on the side of this police car that another officer had pulled up immediately in front of him. And as you see this officer punching Marcus Cheater in the face, saying, "Let go my gun, let go my gun, stop resisting arrest," Marcus Cheater had his hand in the air. And as they pulled him out of the car, Marcus Cheater had his hands in the air. Prosecutor said, "I never saw the tape. They hid it. All charges dropped against Marcus Cheater. No videotape. Marcus Cheater's in would have been something different." But let me tell you something. I have said this to individuals, and I am really serious about this. The issue of police brutality is not a black-white issue. It's a blue issue. It's an overuse of authority issue. Because the man that was punching Marcus Cheater in his face was a cop of color. Race only makes it worse, but it's not the central issue. One officer retires without his compensation, other two were indicted. My son sees this tape, my 14-year-old, and he says, "They lied." He said, "It's a script. It's a script. It's a script." And for me, Mark, Michael Brown was not a gentleman that was laying in the street for 4 hours. He became my 14-year-old black son. I live on the golf course. But I understood and realized that my son is as black as today. And if he chose to wear his designer jeans a little bit below his hip, they may just think he's a thug. Yep. My son has a little swagger to him because he comes from good genes. So when you step to my son might step back to you. And if you ask him, "What you doing here?" my son may say, "What you doing here? I live in the neighborhood. What about you?" But see, it's that behavior coming from a black man that could get him shot. And that became my fear. Third, and so I, as president of the National Bar Association, decided to channel my anger into reform. And it's going to be what comes from the reform that determines what the effect of Ferguson really is. See, it became clear to me that if the leaders went home after day one in Ferguson, or home after day 45, U.S. senators wouldn't have been listening to me. Folks wouldn't have been inviting me to their colleges to speak. And we couldn't have been pushing our reform. So here's what we decided to do, because see, in the National Bar Association, the issue of police brutality is not something that we developed because of Mike Brown, but it was a platform that we put together before the situation happened. I had a young man come to me who practices in this area for over 25 years, and he told me, President-elect means what you see in New York with Eric Garner. That happens every day. And if black lawyers don't do something about this, then the paper on which their degrees are written is worthless. And I agreed with him. Charles Hamilton Houston said that the lawyer has a choice. They can be a social engineer or a parasite on society. And unfortunately, members of the National Bar Association have been a parasite on society. But if I had anything to do with it, dragging, kicking, or screaming, they were going to become social engineers, whether they liked it or not. And as we began to discuss the issue of police brutality, I got together prosecutors who began to explain to me how the system just was really messed up. And I said to them, well, if all of these shootings has happened, let's just get the data. What can we do about this? Go to Eric Holder and tell him to do something about this. They said it's not that easy. The federal government cannot come in and investigate. Evidence must be brought to them, and then they can determine if that evidence established a pattern and a practice, and you've heard that term a lot now, of discrimination. So I said, well, we're lawyers. Let's gather the information. So what we did was pick 25 cities across America, and we decided to gather the information of police-involved shootings. Because you guys, do you know there's not a national database? Do you know this information is not collected on a whole? And do you know without data and without collecting this information, senators would actually have the nerve to tell you, let's study the issue some more, let's get more data on it. Well, if you're not collecting the data, how are you gonna get more data on it? And so we began to send open records requests to these 25 police departments in these 25 states. The goal was to compile a report, to send that report with recommendations in it to Eric Holder, to point out to him those locations that had pattern and practice, those cases that he immediately needed to jump on. We started finding out that we didn't have that long to wait. In addition, what we did was, is if you're going to critique and judge a location, you have to be willing to help the location. So what we did is start Know Your Rights Because It Can Save Your Life forms. And we went into those 25 locations and we went into the community without any cameras, without any fanfare, and we began to teach people in low-income areas, in black and brown areas, how to interact and confront the police when you meet them. We began to teach them their rights, and we also let them know that even though you have these rights, we are very angry that sometimes if you actually exercise your rights, it may not end up positively for you. Nothing was as disturbing as when I went to Arkansas and the chief of police, who is African American, got up and said, I am so sick of you all running off to Ferguson, sensationalizing this mess. You need to take care of your own problem in your own black yard. Then he started to rattle off black on black crime. And then he said at the end of his presentation, I am sick of scraping your children up off the ground. And I said, brother, you know, I've tolerated you as long as I can. But if I was y'all, I would be at his doorstep and I would be asking for removal. Because here's the real fact. Had that been a white police officer sitting next to me that had said those words, there would have been a petition put together asking for his immediate removal. A part of the reason we can't go from a moment to a movement is because we don't hold those that look like us accountable. I wanted him gone because his gun can shoot my child just like anybody else's gun can. We let people know when we went into the community that we didn't have a war against police. We had a war against bad police officers. I got a war against bad teachers, bad doctors, bad lawyers, bad judges. I want to get rid of all of them. Anything that's bad spoils the bunch. on the state level, on the federal level, and the local level. On the local level, we lobbied that there be stricter mental health testing, because the data showed us that a large percentage of police officers did the greatest job in the world, which is serving our armed services. And sometimes we don't celebrate those people enough and give them the support that they need when they come back from service. And there's a federal grant program whereby the government will give a police department money in order to take veterans. But there is no type of mental health treatment connected to that. So can you imagine someone who's been locked up in war? My father was in Vietnam, and they have a flashback in the middle of doing their job. So we said stricter mental health testing, mandatory race relation training, and mandatory de-escalation of force training. Now some of y'all are saying race training ain't gonna matter. You know, it's not really a race issue. But let me tell you why I said it is part of the problem. When you have a police officer that's been on the force for over 28 years, and he dresses his five-year-old daughter up in his police officer outfit, and he has her dancing to the national anthem of the Ku Klux Klan, we have a problem. When in Florida, there are two departments where the head of the Ku Klux Klan is the sheriff, y'all, we have a problem. When a group of police officers in California engage in an exchange of email, and the one officer says to his colleague, "My wife's friend has brought her nigger boyfriend over here with her. Do you think I should get out my gun?" And the response is absolutely, because the monkey may revert back to his primitive ways. When we got that, y'all, Houston, we got a problem. Implicit bias is real. And the effect of Ferguson, one of the effects, has been that locations like Oakland, California, the Attorney General has required as a part of their remediating efforts is that they do implicit bias training. Ferguson effect. In addition, on a state level, we said, look, independent prosecutors, independent investigators in any police-involved shooting or any police-involved case. Why? Not that we necessarily believe that every officer was wrong, but when the trust in a community is broken, nothing the person says will be believed. And the best story I can give that would make media people laugh, but they would get it, is I said, if I cheated on my husband and he graciously decided to take me back, every time I left the house, he said, "Baby, I love you, but where you going? Who are you with? Come on, let me look at your phone." Because the trust is broken. And until the trust is rebuilt, nothing that you say or do will really be believed by the individual. We have some repairing to do in our communities, because as a country, as a nation, we have passed laws and we have done a lot of things, but the one thing we've never done is really address the elephant that sits in the middle of the room, and that is race. And until we have the honest conversation that doesn't make our white counterparts feel defensive or make us feel like the spokesperson, and find ways to fix it, this cycle will continue and continue. So we said independent prosecutors, independent investigators. Five states followed our lead. Mississippi, Texas, Florida, Missouri, and California. They understood that rebuilding meant reshaping. On a national level, and I'm almost done, we said you must change the standard. Have you ever heard the phrases? I thought he had a gun.
Yep.
I thought he had a knife.
Yep.
I thought he reached for a gun.
Yep.
Officers don't say that for no reason. We can march as much as we want to. We can die in and we can shut it down. It's necessary. It's called civil disobedience. But you must have some direct action that comes after that. The reason officers are not indicted is not because the people that sit on grand juries are racist. The reason that officers are not indicted is not because the prosecutors are necessarily racist. It's because in 1985, the U.S. Supreme Court sent out a case called Tennessee versus Gardner. And in that case, the Supreme Court said that an officer had the ability to elevate force to the degree that he or she believed was reasonable to stop the force that he or she perceived. Now, as a lawyer, oh, come on, Dr. Scott, see, the lawyer, the, you know, the logic in him just woke up. Because I got two problems, they got two words that cause me problem. Elevate to the force that he, because of the danger he perceives. It's subjective, and anything that's subjective is never good because it doesn't give guidance. So if an officer says, I believe that he was about to get me, they can use the measure of force in order to stop the danger. So I have been teaching individuals, stop saying police brutality is happening, because it really isn't. They are applying Tennessee versus Gardner to their action and their use. You want to end it? It doesn't feel right in your belly. It doesn't look right to your eyes. If it walks like a duck and quacks like a duck, it's a duck, right? If you don't like it, change the law. And you can't change the law on the local level. Can't change the law on the state level. Federal law can only be changed by the federal government. Congress has to change the law. So we wrote a law saying mandatory de-escalation of force training, a succinct definition to escalation of force and de-escalation of force. Here's the last thing you have to understand. When an officer arrives at a situation, he is trained, right, to approach the situation in a defensive posture in order to protect himself. So when he approaches a car, and we tell people, don't move. Don't even try to get your stuff out before you come. Stand still, because any movement that you make, depending on what color you are, you may get shot. And he can say, I thought they were reaching for a gun in the car. You've heard that a lot of times, that folks will say, well, I saw the tape, it didn't look like, well, that's what you think you saw. But can you imagine yourself sitting in a grand jury room, and an officer gets up and testifies and says, I perceive, I thought? Most folks are not going to substitute their judgment for the officer's judgment in a heat of moment. And then most of the folks, you know, the ones that grab their purses when the black man walk around, even in the suit, is definitely gonna say, well, I understand how you feel about it. That's the issue, it's the standard. And so we said a succinct definition. How many of you all are aware of the case with the little girl in McKinney, Texas, where the officer was sitting on her back coming from the pool party? They had a pool party, right? What most people did not see in that tape is there was another officer that was actually standing to the side, and he was doing what good officers do. The maniac came into the situation, and he escalated the situation. Officers have a responsibility to de-escalate the situation. The other officer was interacting with the young people. He was chatting with the young people. He was getting the story. The other maniac was acting like he was 15. He escalated children, and children responded like children. But it's the law that resulted in no indictment. Don't get put off by the trees. See the forest, see beyond it, because if you don't fix the law, we'll be right back here again. And then the last thing, we cannot do what we did in the 60s. We passed the Voting Rights Act, the Civil Rights Act, the Immigration Act, but nobody stayed around to watch to see whether or not the application of that law actually changed the situation. It means very little to pass a law. if the application of that law results in the same inequity, it means nothing. So the Ferguson effect, we'll have to see, and it's contingent on what you decide to do right here in Stan, Virginia. Thank you.
Attorney Means is eager to interact with all of you with questions and comments, and for anyone who would like to ask a question or make a comment, I have a ready microphone, so please feel free.
Because one thing you can immediately do is go to the National Bar Association website, download the local law. Go to your local city council and say, pass this law now. And you can do it because reform on the local level only requires them to put an ordinance in place, because I do municipal law, and to read it a couple of times, and it's law. And they can affect law in that way because They will actually be able, with the stricter mental health testing, with the mandatory de-escalation of force training, and the mandatory race-related training, that really can impact. Another thing is you can set up a lobby group that petitions and lobbies your state to pass a state law. Independent prosecutor, independent investigator. We said take it to the attorney general. Allow the attorney general to have an investigator. It doesn't require any more money within their office in order to do that. Another thing is you know, legal reform is but a piece of the pie that's going to solve this problem. One of the things that I did during Ferguson was I was very angry that the leaders there had no clue of solutions. I get tired of people talking about the problem. I like to hear about the solutions. One gentleman actually recommended that we stop having any marches, any protests, and we get in a room as leaders, lock ourselves in, and come up with not a leader, but at least an agenda that we can all promote. And we said that's a good idea, except for some brother said, well, I kind of got this march on Monday. So what I decided as president of the National Bar Association is I won't participate in any more of that. And what I did was I mobilized a team to start doing voter mobilization. And I'm just not talking about telling people to vote. I actually had people that would spend 10 to 12 hours on Friday and Saturday going to have conversation with individuals about why it is important to vote. And why? Because see, why is it important? And I know people say, the young people say, honey, we'd have done that. But see, if you got legislators there who are saying that they're not gonna pass the laws, then you're just gonna be marching and dying in, and you're not gonna change anything. We have to start giving people pink slips. We don't work for them, they work for us. Contrary to belief, so that's another thing you can do. You can start doing voter mobilization, not voter drives. That's going into the community, educating people why it's necessary to vote. We did this for over a month and a half. We were a part of that coalition that you see, why Ferguson board changed. We didn't tell people who to vote for, we told them to vote. We took over 150 lawyers and we partnered them with people in the community, and we let the community lead us instead of us leading the people. So you can organize and do that, and that's very effective. Another thing is you can start having that real conversation right here on campus and not be afraid of it. That's what you can do. Does that answer your question?
Yes, ma'am.
Are those practical things? Okay.
So we talked about voting and law. So I was wondering, do you think about going after the two-party filter system, the brutality issue will change, or the law will change?
Say that again, I couldn't hear you.
Do you think
Without going after the what?
Without going after the two-party corporate system, do you think the police brutality issue will change or the law will change?
I think targeting the two parties is a really good thing in this sense that it brings exposures to the issue. But I don't think that's really where the real change is going to happen. Normally, the response doesn't come until people's pockets are impacted. Remember the shootings in South Carolina? And remember there was a push to take down the flag? Remember that? And initially, the governor said no. She said no. Does anybody know why it is she eventually said yes? See, everybody on this side said the protest. No, it was Walmart, it was Boeing, it was the corporations who said, we are pulling out conferences in your area. We're not going to no longer sell the Confederate. And all of a sudden, she got a conscience. When you start going after the corporations and getting them to speak out on this issue, in conjunction with the two political parties, no, I don't think it would change, and I'll tell you why. The police have a very sophisticated, very structured lobbying system. And I actually went to go see Senator Grassley during my day on the Hill. And I lobbied to him that it was the law that was the problem. And he said, no, it's not the law because we don't have enough evidence. And I said to him, and this was before the Freddie Gray incident, I said, let me see if I understand this. You're going to keep on doing what you're going to do, and young folks are going to burn down and tear down these cities, and then you're going to listen. Then you're going to call me up, and all of a sudden, you're going to say, let's change the law. 3 weeks later, Freddie Gray happened. What the guy said to me in the room, though, he said, well, I don't want to make the police unions mad at me. They're powerful. So it's that power until that structure. And what we have to fight with, we don't have major lobbyists. We have the civil disobedience. And so we have to go after partners in economic settings that will help us and go after other entities. And that's why you see groups like Black Lives Matter coming after the political candidates because they want to expose the issue. But I think it's gonna be civil disobedience, to be honest with you, that's gonna get the law to change. Nothing got the voting right. Remember, when Martin Luther King was trying to pass the Voting Rights Act, if you watched Selma, if you watched it, the president was completely opposed to it. And he only agreed when it was clear that there was nothing he could do or say to stop those people from crossing a bridge, from marching, from bringing attention. And other nations said, so this is the way you treat your people, and you're over here trying to tell us that we need to treat our people better. That's when they got conscious. So that's what you have to do. And that's why history is so important, because it gives us something. We don't have to do it the same way. So that's what I believe. Did that answer your question? Thank you.
You said that police pull you over, don't do anything. I want my kids to do the proper procedure, whatever they should do.
Absolutely, that's great. I wish I would have brought with me the little card and I would send them back to Ms. Scott. It's called your rights, your constitutional rights. One thing I tell individuals is to take this, get two of them. Take one to the visor of your car, put one in your pocket. In one, five little sentences, it gives you all of your right. Do you guys know you have a right do you have to give the police officers your ID?
No.
Okay. If they pull you over on a traffic stop, do you have to give the police officer your ID?
No.
Yes, you do. If the reason the officer stops you gives them a probable cause of crime being committed, it is presumed by law that when they're pulling you over for a traffic stop, that that's it. You're walking on the street. There's a difference in teaching your children. There's a difference between talking to the police, right, and being detained by the police. If you are just chatting with the police, you have to tell them nothing. Give them nothing, tell them nothing. And one, the first question you should ask is, am I being detained? And if they say no, don't debate with them. Walk away and keep walking. Police have a license to lie to you. It's called an investigative tactic. So another thing I want you to tell your children is don't be trying to explain their way out of anything. Because more than likely, they're going to be digging ditches that I can't get them out of them. That the most important thing is live to fight another day. Okay, when you're in a car, the reason I say you put your hands on the wheel like this. You put your hands on the wheel like this and you don't move. The reason, because remember I told you police are trained to operate in a defensive manner. And if you move or shake or do anything, it legitimizes or gives them a basis, a reason to say that they can do it. So you make still. You don't exit the car. Don't roll your window down all the way. You don't have to do that. You can do it half of the way. And then what I want you to do most importantly is download this app that the ACLU put together, and it is called the Police Brutality Tracking App. And what this app is it can download onto your phone. And as soon as you get pulled over by the police, you can activate this app. And you would have programmed it to set it up to send to 5 different individuals. It will immediately tell those 5 individuals where you are. And then I would begin to tape the police. I would have a cam in my car, taping the police. The good thing about the ACLU cam is that even if they took your phone, the data that's collected by that app goes to their central station and it can never be destroyed. Why do I say this is important? In Miami, Florida, there was a young man at this thing called Freaknik. Have you guys heard of that? And the cops thought that he had ran over another cop, so they chased him. 15 officers surrounded him and loaded 114 bullets into his car. This young man actually was videotaping the incident. A police officer came over to him, put the barrel of the gun next to his head, and said, give me the MFN tape. Give me your phone. Luckily, the guy had taken the chip out and put it underneath his mouth, gave him the phone, but he kept the chip. The ACUL app, though, sends it straight to the location. So I would tell your child, don't argue with the officers. Know their rights, because they have a right to remain silent. They have the right to say to an officer, if you're gonna detain me, to allow me to call someone to pick up my personal property. They have a right. You know, they can't search without your right. And so those rights are something you hold. But I wouldn't debate with an officer. And I will tell you, really, as a mother, and as a lawyer, it really angers me that in 2015, I have to stand before African Americans and tell them, we have these constitutional rights, but you can't exercise them because you may end up dead. I don't know if you remember the situation with the young man who officers pulled over. He was a college student, and the officer told him to go into his pocket and to get out his ID. He goes into his pocket and gets out. Begins to take out his ID, the cop immediately starts to shoot him. He loads over 14 bullets into his body. The officer said, I thought he was reaching for a gun. I thought I saw a gun in his coat. It was a common one. But when you have a perception before you get to a situation that by the very color of my skin and the very gender of who I am, that I am a danger, that I am dangerous, you come to that situation already fearing me. So the measure of force that you use is going to be different than when you're using it on my brothers. White man goes into Walmart, steals a cash register, terrorizes the whole store, leads the police on a high-speed chase, reaches for the police gun 3 times. They taser him. Black man standing in a Walmart in Ohio, leaning on a gun, talking on the phone to his girlfriend, and in 0.06 seconds, they shoot and kill him. white man standing in Ohio in a gun-carrying state, waving the gun around, pointing at individuals. Instead of shooting him, they calmed him down. 13-year-old boy playing in the park with a toy gun in 0.0.4 seconds, they shoot him down. White woman gets angry because she didn't get tenure, walks into her colleague's office, shoots everyone in the office. Instead of gunning her down, they calm her down. White man sees a Batman movie, decides now he's seeing characters, goes into a theater, shoots over and injures over 114 people, and they calm him down. White man goes into a crowd, shoots and kills a federal judge, a 5-year-old girl, and injures a U.S. congresswoman. They don't gun him down. They calm him down. White man walks into an AME church, has Bible study with them, shoots 9 to 10 people. They look for him. They apprehend him, they put their guns up, and they approach him, and they arrest him. But before they take him to jail, they take him to Burger King to get him something to eat. The federal judge says, when the families are saying, "We forgive you," the federal judge says, "I hope we're also praying for the families of the guy that did the shooting, because they're in pain. Also, you are wondering why people around the country are fed up. Again, I will say, the real effect of Ferguson will depend on what you here in Stanton do. And it will more importantly depend on what folk who don't even look anything like me, but they choose to do."
There's a reception to follow, but before we go to the reception, are there any more questions? Because we don't want to shut you off prematurely. There's one back there.
I just had a question, like, do you personally feel like, why do you personally feel like it is like the way it is today? Like, people say we made a lot of progress, me personally, I don't feel like we have. But I just want to know why, what do you think about it?
I agree with you. I agree with you. I think instead of us celebrating the civil rights movement and talking about what we've accomplished, we got to look closely at actually what we've lost. And I think we're at this place because we failed to make certain that there was an application of the law and for us to deal with our real issues. And until as a nation we understand that racism is not something that is born, it is something that is taught. And that, have you ever seen a picture of a little black and white child hugging each other and holding each other? Because that's their natural thing. I believe that until we deal with those issues, that we're going to be back here having this conversation again.
I just feel that it is absolutely ridiculous that I'm sitting here thinking to myself, like, I hope and pray that I never get pulled over by myself in a car. And I really just want to know, like, what do you do when things such as this are happening? And people such as myself, a college student, I can't join my sisters and my brothers, and we can try to go to different corporations and make change, but we ourselves can't do a lot because, you know, without money, there's not a lot that we can do, honestly. So I just feel like it's very ridiculous that I'm sitting here literally thinking, like, I really hope I'm going to be put over by myself, you know what I'm saying? Because it is a very uneasy feeling. It is a very uneasy feeling. And I just want to know, like, what do you do? How do you strengthen yourself? Because I really need it. And I'm sure so many men and women in here need it as well.
Well, I disagree with you that there isn't anything you can do. And I disagree with you that your resources limit you to what you can do. If young people in Ferguson felt that way, because it was the young people in Ferguson, it was the college students, those weren't the hoodlums out there. Those were the college students with the community people, and they were making their voices be heard. But you know what they're doing now? They're actually having meetings with police
with, they're actually having meetings with the police force in Ferguson, and they're talking about, also in the city of St. Louis, they're having real conversations about how to learn and appreciate African Americans. They're really doing implicit bias training is what they're doing, and they're coming up with a system of how they can work together. So no, I do think that you can take the law, and you can take a group of your students, and you can go to whatever the city hall is here and say, we must make a change. Never feel powerless like you can't do it. But I do agree with you. This is personal for me. I have a 14-year-old, a 10-year-old, a 7-year-old, and a 4-year-old. It's very personal. I don't want to bury my children. And more importantly, if the cops kill my children, I don't want any of you guys coming to march with me. Okay? I don't want you to, because I'm giving you an opportunity to join the change now.
Right.
So this is it. Activate. You got to say it's not their problem. It's America's problem. So you're not powerless. So I do this. I go around the country. I did the Know Your Rights. You can take and I can teach you the law. And you can go into the community and you can teach those kids the law. That's what you can do. And it doesn't take a fanfare to do that, nor money to do that. And if it does and you need copy of money, I'll give you $100 before I leave to make the copies. And those people, they can do that. That you have to accept the fact that perhaps you do everything right and it ends up wrong. And that's okay. You gotta speak that and you gotta release that and you gotta find someone to release it to. So you're not powerless.
Thank you.
You said it's really important for us to vote, but I know in the state I live in, they like to redraw the district, so it'll be more uneven to where people will vote whatever they prefer that we vote. So what do you think people should do about that situation?
I don't know if any of you guys are familiar with the Mississippi case where this happened, where they are redrawing the district so that they are going to almost redistrict out all of the black representatives. They filed a lawsuit. They filed a lawsuit to say the redistricting is discriminatory. I think one thing that we do is we never pay attention to an issue until there's a big moment. And that's the point I'm really trying to get across to you guys. If there's going to be real change, it has to be a movement. So I say in situations where that redistricting is happening, it's very important for people like you to say, do you realize, council, what you're really doing? Because I see what you're doing, and it's wrong, because it's shutting people out from voting. And so then the Voting Rights Act means nothing. So I think you have to, and the people that's in the seats is doing it, can only not do it if they're not there. So if they're trying to do it now, you better get back to the election and make sure they don't get back reelected.
Yes, ma'am. Do you think that black officers have been desensitized to race, not caring about the well-being of other black people?
I don't think they've been desensitized to it. I think they have brought into the blue to officers. There is something in police culture called the thin blue line. And the thin blue line is that, you know, you don't rat out another officer. You don't tell. Did anyone see the case in Charlotte, South Carolina, where the gentleman got killed and then the officer did a report and said the gentleman was reaching for his taser or his gun, but then there was a gentleman that had videotaped it and you clearly saw that wasn't happening? Did you notice, though, that there was a black cop that was standing next to the individual and asked the individual to drop whatever object was that was on the floor? The officer didn't do anything. If you read the officer's report right, it had no mention of it. The National Bar Association actually said, fire that black officer.
Sure.
I don't think it's a desensitizing. I think it's a buying into the blue culture. And I believe also it's coupled with some self-hatred of not loving who we are and automatically believing and embracing stereotypes about who we are. And then they become the spokesperson because, you know, they don't put them on the air when a white kid is shot. They put them on the air when a black kid is shot and say the black kid should have cooperated. But I've seen a lot of cops, right, where people are cussing the police out and doing everything, and they don't get shot. Mm-hmm.
Yes. So I really think it is a combination of those two things, the thin line, and then I think it's a desensitizing, because I've seen black cops say to me that I went to Mississippi and they told me we don't have a problem here. And they said, he said, don't listen to anything the president of the National Bar Association says. I disagree with everything she said. If I pull you over, you better not exercise your rights to me, even if you're a lawyer. And all the black lawyers sat in the room and didn't say anything. And I jumped up and said, have you lost your mind? Because you do have a problem. The fact that you feel comfortable enough to get on stage in front of these 120 young black men and say that, and we were passing out the Know Your Right cards, and you know what the police officer said? Why are you giving those black young men these cards? You're only going to make it worse. As if knowing your rights. And you know what? You know what we don't do when black cops do wrong? We don't say they're wrong. We make excuses. Again, a gun. And a Hispanic, a black, or a white officer is a gun that can shoot my son.
Right.
And if you bad, you gotta go. So I think if you read, and there is some reading out there, and there are some officers that have actually been knighted, you know, because they say they get really harassed when they actually do speak up. They get really, I don't know if you know Johnson, the one that was brought into the Ferguson situation. They brought Johnson in because they really wanted to calm the black people down in Ferguson. And when Johnson first came in, Johnson had a lot of credibility. But do you know what they're not telling you? Is that when they brought Johnson in, the white officers in Ferguson and St. Louis County got angry. So when 911 calls would come in, they say, we're not gonna answer it. They did not answer it. And when the tear gas that went out, Johnson ain't telling you the truth because I got the emails, they didn't tell him anything about what they were gonna do. They started to punish this brother. So I said to the black community, when someone takes the step to do the right thing, we have to cover them. Because if they're not doing the right thing, then we uncover them, but then we have to cover them. So if you look at some of the stuff that's happening, that's the tension. It is one, some of it may be, but I think the pendulum line plays a lot to do with it. Or the another hand, it's me.
What kind of advice would you give to those of us who are looking to pursue a job in the criminal justice field?
I would say, first, research. What you mean by the criminal justice field is very wide. You want to be a police officer? Do you want to be a parole officer? There are very various things. I'm not in the criminal justice area. I don't even practice civil rights, but for me, this is a human issue. I would say go and find some good officers that you can actually sit and talk with. Here's another thing we did with our police brutality workshops that we did. We invited in the prosecutor's office and the sheriff's office, and we had conversations with them, because that matters. So I would say have conversations and share, and I think that's how you learn about the profession. There was one hand.
Earlier you spoke about how corporations can benefit the cause. But do you think that there can also be situations where corporations can take away from the cause, such as the situation where Walmart donated money to Gary Wilson's legal fund?
Sure, absolutely. I think anything can be good in there. I think politicians can be good, but I think they can be bad. But what I know in America, and I've been a partner, I've been at my firm 19 years, and people say we argue over the issue of black, white, blah, blah, blah. I said the only color that really matters, and I'm telling you this as young people, people can tell you what they want to tell you. The color that matters is green. And it's about the access to the green. And if you can impact the green that comes and flows to somebody, it has an impact on them. So yes, corporations have sometimes impeded progress. And sometimes, depending on what, if a group is getting money, I've seen the National Bar Association, the Urban League, the NAACP, remain quiet on situations as it related to discrimination at companies because they were receiving sponsorship from them. And you have to ask yourself, are you for hire or are you not for hire? And if you're not for hire, I mean, people will take from you what you let them take from you. They will exercise the power over you that you give them. So remember, good and bad characters and actors everywhere.
They're trying to get police officers to start wearing body cameras. Mm-hmm. Do you think that will actually create a difference in like the level of police brutality that's happening now?
Yes, I do not think it's a solution, but I do think that it contributes to the solution, as Marcus Jeter, and that's why I told you his story. In the case of Eric Garner, people said the video camera didn't mean anything, but what they didn't do in the Eric Garner case is actually apply the law to the Eric Garner situation, and they didn't get indicted because of the law. But the body camera, if you notice, this is what happens. Police officers will tell one narrative when something happens, and the narrative won't change if there isn't a videotape. What would have happened, you know, if we didn't have videotapes and others? Have you imagined how many people have gone to jail because the officer's story was this and their story was that, and then you're inclined not to believe that person, but you're always going to believe this person? So I absolutely think body cameras helped. The senator from South Carolina just introduced a bill, him and Cory Booker, on putting grants out for body cameras. But can I say this to you? Any bill that does not have consequences for tampering with and manipulating the body cameras is not a real deal. Mm-hmm. So if it all it requires is body cameras, but if officers feel there's a consequence to doing what they're doing, then they won't do it. So they shouldn't be able to turn it off, tamper with it, or any of that. Let it play so that the story will be able to be seen. Yes, ma'am.
Okay, just like piggybacking off of what she said about body cameras, do you think because of the app, like ACLU, do you think it would be beneficial for them to, like, if they were to have a body camera on them, that every single time it's being turned on or turned off, that the data goes straight to, like, to a higher storing thing so no one can tamper with it and they'll just be...
Well, I don't think there should be a national center to gather all taping of body cameras, because every laws in every state is kind of different. And so I think there should be a central place at that police department where it cannot be tampered with, and to protect the evidence. There's legal issues of what can be introduced also and what cannot be introduced. But right now, we're more so dealing with the issue of whether or not it's credible. And so yes, there should be a place where that information is centered to in that police department, right? And then it is stored and the evidence is heard. Now, I know a lot of people say, well, body cameras are expensive. Oh, they're really, really expensive. Well, everything's expensive. But there are federal grants out there where states can apply for to utilize some of those funds to get the body camera. And that's the stuff you should be researching in your area and then presenting it to the city council for individuals who say we can't afford to have them.
I want to urge you all to come and join us with Pamela Means at the reception, which is to follow at Hunt Gallery. But before we retire for the evening from this room, we have one more thing to do. We have a special presentation, and Rolanda's coming to do that right now.
I wanted to, first of all, thank everybody for coming today. It is really a pleasure to see so many faces from the Mary Baldwin community come out, including faculty and staff. We really do appreciate your support and appreciate you coming out to share this moment with us, to be able to have her come and speak about the Ferguson effect. I also wanted to thank Souls and on behalf of MCU as well as EPC for putting this together, and Office of Inclusive Excellence, my lovely advisor, Andrea Burnett Scott. And we wanted to give you a gift and your flowers to thank you.